You know, as you guys can probably tell, all of our panelists have just a wide perspective and variety of writing experience in their careers, spanning across many of the genres in television. So I'd like to start off the conversation with us talking about what are all of the major distinctions in the different writing styles that you guys have kind of done in your careers, in your time. I'll open it up to whoever wants to answer. Anybody?
Well, please, after you, Mark.
TV animation is different because it's different from almost any other kind of writing in TV in that you're calling the shot, you're calling a camera angle, and you're giving the vision for the whole show. It really starts, for the most part, with the writer, and your script is the sort of creative vision, and then it's handed off to the production staff. And so that's really the major difference in TV animation.
You want to explain a little bit about when you say calling the shots, specifically?
Yeah, you know, I have a production background, and then I got to animation, and then I'm going, well, I don't have to rent a dolly or a crane. I can just say, track with Bobby as he, you know, drives a sleek Aston Martin down in with a James Bond scarf flying behind him. You know, that's, so you can call, you know, close-ups, tracking shots, that type of thing. Whereas, you know, you don't really do that in TV, mm-hmm. other TV writing sitcoms, hour.
It's verboten.
Yeah, you're just not allowed. But you're supposed to do that
in
TV animation.
Yeah, they want you to basically explain every single shot as you're writing it. Mm-hmm. Whereas in other scripts, you wouldn't necessarily put all of those details.
No, you wouldn't.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, in television, television scripts are known for being very parsimonious when it comes to stage directions. Very brief, one, two lines, basically is about it. But the unique thing of writing for, we divide television into two categories, ad-supported television and cable television. But in ad-supported television, the most interesting dynamic is that you're sort of forced to create in a world that somebody else already established. You come on board as a staff writer, working in a world with characters that somebody's already created, already established, and then you have to find a way to create stories that seamlessly fit into the evolution of the series as it advances through the various seasons. Writing for television is very, very unique. As Mark mentioned, with animation writing, with animation, you are in total control. Whereas in live television, ad-supported television, you really have to just describe what you're seeing, what the characters are saying, and that's it. The director rules the set, the director calls the shot, the director covers the scenes. All you do is basically write in master shot.
Mm-hmm. 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 And it's interesting because we talk a little bit about the difference between ad-supported or, cable versus, you know, broadcast. And that's one of the places where reality television actually overlaps because when you're writing, when you have commercials, there's this very specific format. So do you want to talk a little bit about where you share in reality?
Well, I'll tell you, there are a lot of things that we share. One of the things that I always say, you know, story is written. When I'm doing reality shows, I'm following the same formats that, you know, an hour-long show would. I'm going to have the same number of act breaks. I'm going to have to somehow go to commercial with you being interested in whatever is happening enough that you're going to come back. The difference is that we retroactively script it. And the way it was explained to me when I started in reality TV is we call it writing with refrigerator magnets. Is you have a finite number of things that I can put them in this order, in this order, in this order, and cut this thing shorter, let them do this. But I only have what's in the bag in order to be able to put these things together. Reality shows, as far as the way that those are written and the way that differs from other types of television is, in reality television, there are so many different strains under this enormous umbrella, and people are always trying to cram variety in there now, and it's not a game show, it's a reality show, and it's not variety, it's this. The reason they do that is because they don't want to pay union writers. But, you know, it's just a big umbrella. It's not a big, don't get hung up on titles. But in reality television, what we do a lot of the time is we'll outline what we're expecting to get for an episode, send that to the field and say, we have these 13 beats we'd like to get for this week. We kind of have an idea of where we want to place them in the episodes. You have to be flexible enough that when something comes up, you can change it. But we do start with a very heavily outlined script most of the time. There are certain shows, if you watch Duck Dynasty, there's a reason why everybody on Duck Dynasty talks like Niles Crane. Like everybody on the show is the pithiest wittiest interview. It's because you have producers that are like, you know, it'd be fun if you said something like this, or they kind of guide people through those interviews. Other shows are a little bit more hands-off. The trouble with reality television and being on a panel like this is trying to explain how it's done. It's done 13 different ways. It just depends on what kind of show you're doing, whether you have a show where you've got 3 days to shoot an episode, or whether you're trying to cull 8 episodes out of 4 months worth of shooting. Mm-hmm. There are myriad approaches to making the stuff, and they all work.
So what? Let's talk a little bit about all the positions, because you know when you say that in reality they call everyone mm-hmm. producer. You're mm-hmm. a story producer. You're a field producer. Everybody's a producer.
Right.
When in fact they're all very different jobs. But let's talk mm-hmm. about the jobs in the story department on a given television show. We'll start with you, Garrick. Do you want to talk a little bit about the writing team?
Yeah, there's very much a hierarchy, if you will. You have the staff writers, you have executive story editor, and you have the showrunner, who is the creator of the series and the executive producer. And then they throw around titles as sort of promotion issues when you've been there long enough. So as a writer, you become a co-producer, and then maybe a co-executive producer. Essentially, the writer's room is a training ground for creating your own show. You spend enough time working in a writer's room, working with other writers, and developing their series, you not only gain credibility with the network, but you gain experience so that at some point in time, you're now ready to take over your own show and be the showrunner and bring on a writing staff of your own. So there's pretty much egalitarianism, if you will, in the writer's room. We're a bunch of crazy writers trying to create stories. And sometimes, as a showrunner once said, it's organized chaos. But at the end of the day, you're creating a story. And that's really what matters. There's something very special about the writer's room, and that in theory, you know, there are a couple of rules. And the first rule is you leave your ego at the door, because it's not personal, it's about the story. It's what can we do to make the story better? And sometimes you've got one person working on a story, sometimes you have two, sometimes more. But the whole point is to create a good story that advances the series, honors the franchise, and continues the legacy, if you will, of that particular show.
Well, I think everybody, has anybody seen the making of South Park? Did anybody watch that on television? Mm-hmm. Okay, do you guys remember the war room writing scene in there? And you also, if anybody watched 40 Rock, they have the writer's room. You know, you talk about egalitarian, and it does sort of feel like there's a bunch of people in a room, and people are just kind of spitballing, throwing ideas out. At least that's how it was in the South Park, for those of you guys who watched it. But how is it decided? I mean, obviously you have somebody there making the decisions, but how does that work?
He or she is called God, and that's the showrunner. And they make the decision. I mean, the final decision rests with them. I mean, they approve stories. And don't forget, we work for a network, so everything goes to network first. The treatment goes to network, they approve it, comes back down, and then we go to script. We get approval to script. But ultimately, the showrunner signs off on it because it is his or her show.
Yeah.
We work at their pleasure.
So how many people, I know it's going to be different for each show, but how many average people would work in a story department than on a major?
I've seen them go from 6 to 12.
6 to 12 people. Yeah. Do they ever break up like different, like, you know, you guys take these episodes, you take these episodes, or everybody works together on each episode?
Well, that's the way Levitan and Chris Lloyd work on Modern Family. They literally split the writers group. They have 10 people, they each take 4, and they work on some series. And when those series are done, they switch and they give each other the scripts, and then they edit those. And they work sort of a bifurcated process because they're two executive producers on that show. So yeah, it does work that way sometimes.
So Mark, in animation, do you guys also have sort of a war room, a story room?
Not so much in animation. It's more, there's not so much a writer's room. It's more individual assignments. And usually you go in and you pitch to the story editor or maybe even the show creator. And, you know, you have a number of pitches, and they'll say, okay, you know, this one here, and they'll give you a little notes, and then go write the outline, you know, and that's, you know, you've got your assignment. But and for the rewrite, as opposed, you know, in sitcoms, it's like the whole room is rewriting your script. No, that's not the way it's done in animation. The story editor will give you the notes, and you will then go back to your desk. Now, sometimes I was on one show, you know, with Howie Mandel, and you know, I went into the there was two showrunners. They were co-creators, and they were giving me notes, you know, and they'd say, you know, and I'm flipping through, and then in comes Howie Mandel, who did the voice for this, you know, the three, and he's like dancing around. He goes into his 3-year-old voice and goes, no. He starts doing a bit, and you're going, well, okay, you know, and then you know, so it's just like you're getting all this input. You know, that was like my first rewrite session with these people, and you know, and you're just writing it down, and then they go, and then Howie Mandel says, oh, I gotta go, you know, and then they, yeah, we gotta go too, and they got it, you got it, and you're going, yeah, I got it, you know. Next one, I used a recorder, but so it's you know, the responsibility is more on a single writer than a whole group of writers.
That makes sense. How is it in reality then with the story team? Can you talk a little bit about
Sure. The
different positions?
The story team, I would tell you, usually most of the shows that I work on, if I'm supervising a story department, I prefer to work in post. There are, again, I say there are many ways to approach reality television. I typically will have between 2 and 6 what we call story producers. The title of story editor used to be used a lot more. They started calling them story producers because story editor sounded suspiciously like an actual job that Writers Guild writers have. So we became story producers. There'll be 2 story producers to 6 story producers. What we will do is, depending on the show, I'll assign individual episodes to those people, and then I'll oversee the full arc for the series so that we have a discussion running. Most of what I do as a co-executive producer on the shows is sort of provide some sense of continuity throughout the episode so that everybody can concentrate on telling their story, and I'm just maintaining the overview for the series. I'm not as hands-on as I had been before because I'm kind of busy putting out fires like, hey, the cast doesn't want to work with us anymore. What do we do? Get on the phone. The way that those outlines usually happen is we'll have a group conversation. We'll decide how we're going to outline the episodes before they get doled out to the individuals there. It's all speculative based on the notes that are coming back from the field or the outlines of what we think it is that we're going to get. The outlines are set in sand so that when something amazing happens in the field, we can figure out a way to incorporate that. There are certain goofy tricks that we do. If I have a scene that is fantastic but doesn't mean anything to the full story, top of act 2. It always goes in the top of act 2 because for some strange reason, no one seems to notice that you're just making noise at the top of act 2. Typically, we'll have 4 to 6 weeks to put an episode together now. It used to be a little bit longer. There is a game that is being played in television now where everything needs to be produced as fast as it can just because. And if you did a great show in 5 weeks last year, I bet you could do the same thing in 4 weeks and it would cost us less money. Mm. And when that works, the next year it'll be 3 weeks. I've said too much. I overshot. I'm in the weeds. I will be back on the fairway by the time we get to the next question.
Well,
but typically, like I say, between 2 to 6 story producers working for a supervising producer or co-executive producer, there is not always a supervising producer. In the absence of a supervising producer, the co-executive producer is basically doing the supervising producer's job plus, whatever else needs to be done.
That brings up a really good point, because when, for example, one of the shows I worked on, which was Dancing with the Stars, mm-hmm. we'd pitch something on, let's see, the show was on Tuesday, so we would pitch it Tuesday morning and to the executives, and then it would be approved by the end of that day, and then you would have, you know, you'd basically have until next Tuesday to do all of your shooting, all of your editing, and deliver it at the end of Monday night for Tuesday's. So, yeah, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I would add to that, just when you're talking about Dancing with the Stars, to go back to something that you had said earlier, about how the network has to sign off on your concepts before you move forward. In reality television, we have a very rigorous setup where the network will get up to 4 screenings of an episode, usually. Rough cut 1, rough cut 2, fine cut, lock cut. And internally, you have to screen before you can actually put things out. So the executive producers or the owners of whatever the production company are will want to come in and watch what it is you're working on. So there is input coming from those other places. We are not operating with complete autonomy. We're just attempting to guess that. And I just realized that I had skimmed over that in my answer.
No, it's a very good point. But
I told you I'd get back on the fairway. And I did.
You made it back.
I did.
Welcome back. But it brings up a good point, because there are many types of shows that we do in television. There are the ones that are done weekly, but then there are also ones that are done, entire series are done before they ever broadcast. Does anybody want to speak a little bit about the difference with writing on those?
Less pressure. When you're doing a show that's in production while you're writing, the pressure is enormous, because you have to turn out that show. That script has to be done. There is no ifs, ands, or buts about it. When you're doing a show ahead of time, obviously you've got the luxury of taking more time. But we really can't answer that question without looking at the bigger picture, and that is the whole television landscape has changed radically in the last 5 to 10 years. Mm-hmm. You have shows, we have the typical pilot season in shows beginning in September, October, and then mid-season replacements. But now you've got shows starting in May, June, March. I mean, there is no schedule anymore. It's all over the board. So consequently, the writing schedule also changes. And then you have shows that for instance, with Mad Men, they've split the season now into two parts, like they did with Breaking Bad. You've got 8, and then you got the final 8. So there's a split there. You've got shows that are given a 10-week order, and then they wait and see what happens. There are a lot of pilots. I've got a list of all the new pilots that have been approved to go to script, and only about maybe a third of them have been given episode orders, and about 70% of those are only for 10 to 12 episodes. Mm-hmm. So they want to play out the series. So it fluctuates. There is no one hardcore rule to answer your question.
And I think that's has a lot to do with also just the way that people work. And, you know, the 8 and the 8, the nice thing about that is when you have the break in between, it gives your staff a chance to kind of regroup and sort of take a breather and kind of figure out the direction a little bit.
Well, let me ask you, Anne. In reality television, there's an interesting conundrum that can present itself, and that is if you were doing a documentary, like a docuseries, like when I was working on Basketball Wives, sometimes you are still in production while the show is airing, if something is rushing to air. If you have a cast that's in play and they are watching themselves at the top of a season, you get into a position where they start self-producing. Mm-hmm. So the calendar on which you're actually producing reality television shows can dramatically affect the outcome of the series itself. If you're in too much of a rush to get it to air and you're trying to air while you're still cutting it, you're going to have cast backlash based on what they're seeing of themselves, because they can't necessarily tell that if something goes wrong, you're going to redeem them later in the series. Mm-hmm. It happened on Surreal Life. It's happened on lots of other shows where people see themselves while the show
is why they out. Don't let them watch them anymore.
Well, they can watch it if it's on television at home.
Yeah.
You know.
How do you handle that backlash?
There's different schools of producing for reality television, and for me, I think complete transparency with your cast is the only way to go. There are a lot of shows where the producers are like, well, you know, get someone to say this or do this or have an argument about this other thing. And when people start to feel that you're presenting their personal lives in a manner that's tainted and that you're controlling it too much, you get into real trouble. So what'll happen is if I have a cast member and I have a missing scene from a show that might require them to confront someone about something that happened a week before, I'll say, look, this doesn't make sense to people at home. If they're watching it and they don't understand why it is you have so much animosity towards this person, we need to figure out a way to get that across. Can you have a conversation with a friend of yours at lunch about what transpired and help me fill in those gaps? And if you're honest with them about how these things are going to work, people are usually very cooperative. You do have some people who are absolutely manic about self-producing and about their image, and people come into reality shows with an agenda, more so now than ever before, because you have people like Bethany Frankel who use their 15 minutes of fame to create and sell $100 million companies. Everybody on a reality show will eventually have a line of handbags or shoes, I've discovered. but people are very worried about what the long-term repercussions of who they are on television are. And when people start self-producing, you start to get less genuine responses, which makes the show less interesting, which makes people tune out. So you just have to be upfront with them.
I also want to add that you get that in
scripted, right?
Scripted television as well, because what happens is you get actors mm-hmm. who become so entrenched and married to their roles, they have their own concept of who these people are. And if a writer comes along and alters something, they rebel. As a matter of fact, more than one producer has exited a series because of a conflict with an actor. One of the more famous cases is Mark Harmon on NCIS. I won't name the producer, but one producer literally was driven from the show because he just put his foot down and said, nope, I'm not going to work with her anymore because of X, Y, or Z. And you got a case where another character got in a fight with a writer, a verbal fight, and he was off the show for six episodes at the beginning of the season. Mm-hmm. So actors take their roles very seriously. I mean, really, really seriously, because they're so emotionally invested in that character.
Well, wouldn't you also say that has a lot to do with the fact that the actor, you know, they are the ones that are there from day one, and they do live those roles. And after a certain number of seasons, it's, you know, the writers can come and go, but the actors are always sort of the consistent thing. So they become sort of the sounding board with what is real, what's not. Would you agree with that?
It even extends to directors. I mean, at this point in television, directors are nothing more than traffic cops because the actors know their characters so well. And most actors have very good relationships with writers. I've always had very good relationships with actors because I understand where they're coming from, maybe more than other writers would. And so you want to address their concerns and their needs. That's why we have a read-through, a table read, before we go into shooting, so they can, you know, express their concerns. But normally it works very well. But it just, they do have a lot of influence. If they want to dig in their heels, they can create issues.
Can I have somebody just tell the audience, for those who aren't familiar with the formatting of television with commercials, somebody break down the typical half-hour show for us?
Well, you've got, first of all, across television, let me include drama with that as well. You have anywhere from 2 to 6 acts, depending on the network. Each network has their own formula. ABC is strictly a 6-act structure for their shows, their hour-long shows. CBS is 4 acts and a teaser. AMC is 4 acts and a teaser. A sitcom, depending whether it's multi-camera or a single-camera show, can be anywhere from 2 acts with a teaser, with a cold open and a tag, to like Modern Family is 3 acts and a tag. So it varies. It used to be you had hardcore rules: 4 acts for all dramas, 2 acts for all sitcoms. And then the FCC lost their regulatory control over networks, and they started going bananas.
Just so you guys understand, we break them, we call them acts, because they sit between one commercial break and another commercial break. So that's considered an act.
We also have specific time limits that are imposed by networks as well for those acts. When I work with VH1, for example, you know, your first act needs to come in between 9 minutes and at the absolute outside 12. Your second act needs to be 9 minutes to, you know, whatever it is. The shortest act I've ever had in a show is, we had an episode of Basketball Wives that I had in 1 minute and 45 seconds. Act 6.
It's always Act 6. Yeah. That's all I can say. It's always Act 6.
Well, the thing is, I also have a personal philosophy that if the lengths of the acts get shorter as you progress, it creates the illusion of movement, like mm-hmm. the show is picking up speed mm-hmm. so that people don't tune out. But we do have the delivery specs for shows absolutely have to be adhered to, and it's very rare that we'll go back to the network and say, is there any way we can get just a little more time to do this? But it's only if you really, really have to.
That's very important. You know, for anybody who wants to be a television writer, you have to be able to deliver it in the format of the network.
Right. Yeah. Just because you write documentaries does not mean you can make it 57 and a half minutes long to fill an hour on PBS, because even PBS needs to have some breaks.
And it's gotten much worse since the FCC lost their regulatory control. I mean, totally. An hour episode of Let's Pick Revenge, which is an ABC show, mm-hmm. A recent episode of Revenge was 42 minutes and 15 seconds.
42?
42.15.
Yeah. Wow.
I thought, wasn't it? That's down then.
So they're really milking. And what you were saying is absolutely correct. In TV, the initial acts tend to be longer than the later acts because they got your hook now. So you're not going to switch channels at this point, so they can bombard you with commercials. Even on news, if you look at the network news, for instance, you'll go 14 minutes without a commercial break, and they hit you with a commercial break after every story. Yeah. Because they figure you're invested now, so you're not going to tune out.
And there's specific ways of creating that break architecture that keeps the viewer tuned right. in. We're not going to, you know, hit you with a bunch of commercials so that you get bored and flip the channel. We're going to grab you as soon as you come out of that show with something that's going to keep you there, hopefully, and right. bring you back.
We have podbusters in reality TV as well now, where it's just sort of just a non sequitur thing that makes noise for 30 seconds that they can stick in the middle of a larger sea of commercials mm-hmm. so that you don't tune out because it comes back and like, did you know there's two kinds of mayonnaise, this and this? More when we come back from this commercial. It's like, it has, what does well, it have what, to do with what I'm doing?
What you're saying is also very important for the writer, because what most writers don't realize is that we have a responsibility to make those breaks substantial. They're called act outs, and we have mm-hmm. to create a moment of suspension, of tension, of, oh my God, what's going to happen next when they cut to commercial. That's our job, and the networks insist on it. So we've all been trained in the basic Aristotelian three-act structure, and you kind of throw that out the window because now you've got a four, five, or six-act structure that you've got to create with these dramatic moments so that the audience will stay tuned when we cut to commercials selling you Pampers and beer.
Well, yes. That brings up a really good point, because you mentioned teasers and tags earlier. Can you elaborate for those who may not be, you know, familiar with those terms, what those mean and how they're used?
It's a hook. A teaser is or a cold open in sitcoms, is a hook to get you to watch the show. In most procedurals, if they use a teaser, you're going to have a murder. So the teaser is the murder. And the tag is sort of wrapping up loose ends. In film, you'd call it the denouement. And it's just sort of wrapping up things. Isn't it nice? Yeah, everybody's great. Go home. And that's pretty much it.
Yeah, and we always put hooks right before the commercial breaks because that's meant to make you come right. out.
And in reality television, we have, and I don't, I have yet to see it used in a drama series, but we have bumpers where if I have an act out that isn't necessarily the strongest thing in the world, but it's like the only way I can give you a coherent story. At the end of act two, we usually do a deep tease where, you know, it'll end and it'll be so-and-so saying like, well, I guess we'll have to talk about this later. And then it says, coming up on Basketball yeah. Wives, and it's yeah. three people going over a table.
Yeah.
That doesn't happen until act six.
Right.
That gives you the same effect of having a dramatic out that's going to make you want to come back and watch the rest of the show.
Yeah. And
I find it unfortunate that it usually ends up being three people going over a table in reality shows. It's just sort of like, can anyone just have
it's
a normal...
It's either that or else somebody getting punched.
Yeah.
There's a lot of punches.
Yeah, but you'll notice, too, reality TV is scaling back on that. The tone of reality television has pulled back from, I think, we had a much meaner spirit 4 or 5 years ago. No, I'm really, I think it's a wonderful thing that now if you see people having a physical altercation on a reality show, mm-hmm. what you will see, and it's one of those things that I've used several times on my shows, is you'll see somebody get upset, you'll see them get up and start moving towards someone else. Someone comes up and you have an interview that interrupts everything that says, and then so-and-so and so-and-so just got up in her face and it was terrible. And then you cut back to the aftermath of the fight as people are pulling somebody off of somebody else rather than reveling in 45 seconds
of
human beings punching each other in the face on a boardwalk. I'm happy that reality TV is reeling itself back in and realizing it doesn't have to be that bad.
You're optimistic.
I am optimistic.
Because I always found when I had my camera on, when they got in fights, I was like, I'm getting out of here, you know. But well, that's why it wasn't on, you know, on camera.
You cover it, but I think too, that's what's happened is there are a couple of reality shows, I can't really talk about it, but there are sponsors that have become very uncomfortable with backing shows where there is an element of violence as part of the show because there's backlash against those sponsors. Mm-hmm. Any change that ever happens in television usually initiates as the network responding to something that the sponsor likes or doesn't like. Because ultimately, in the end of it, what we are doing, as entertaining as we would like to think we are there for the grace of soap companies mm-hmm. that have things that they have to sell.
Yeah, and you know, in animation, you do the same thing. You've got to get them some action to tease them, to keep their attention. You've got to have that cliffhanger, you know, the end of act one and act two. But, you know, and why? Because you have, people are going to flip the channel if you don't. And because of the soap commercials. And I kind of wonder, you know, with Netflix now coming out, with all their programming, is that going to change things? You know, is that going to, if we're not having to, you know, cliffhanger to a commercial, if we're not going to have a commercial, what's going to happen? You know, is that going to change our
Well, writing? I mean, but the net, the you know, HBO, their shows, none of those are commercial break shows, so they're done a lot more like scripted, mm-hmm. like film. You know, they're much more in keeping with that three-act structure that we all know
with
about.
With Netflix and things like that, the thing that I think will ultimately be interesting is there are shows that play continuously very well, but I wonder if anything that runs on Netflix will eventually be repurposed for resale in other countries as a regular airing show that has breaks. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of stuff that's happening, especially with web content. There's a company called ViewGuru that I've been really interested in for a while. And what they do is they produce hour-long content, but it's broken into 7 to 10 minute chunks as standalone episodes for the web. But when you click all the pieces together, you've got an hour-long piece. So they're producing something that can be used in myriad ways and formats.
Yeah,
so that if I want to sell it in Colombia or I want to sell it in Poland, you know, then they can take it apart and put commercials in the middle of it and run it however they want to run it.
I don't think that TV is advertising is going to go away. And let me explain what I mean by that. They're so conscious and protective of that. They've even arranged for DVD rebroadcast to have commercials embedded that you cannot fast forward anymore. They've locked the commercials in, so you must, even on DVRs, you must watch the commercials. It's gotten to that point. So commercials aren't going away. We're always going to have broadcast television. We're always going to have commercials, and they're going to find ways to keep you watching them. Used to be you could fast forward through commercials. You can't do that anymore. And even at the point where ABC is come up with a new policy where they're not allowing current episodes to be seen until after the first week. And they're getting really, really protective about that. So they're protecting their interests. Ad-supported television is here to stay. But, you know, we do have other choices in terms of cable, for instance, which quite frankly, I think we owe a debt of gratitude because it is the premium cable channels that have sort of forced broadcast television to increase the quality of their programming. Mm-hmm. We have some incredible shows today that are on the air and more coming. I've got a list of pilots that I've been reading through for the upcoming season, and there's some really interesting stories that I know would never have seen the light of day if it hadn't been for all the quality programming that came out of HBO, Showtime, Stars, Cinemax, et cetera.
Right. So talk a little bit, Garrick, about, you know, when you're writing for a crime series or something that's a drama, how much thought are you giving to production costs in your writing? And do you make those considerations when you're writing your scripts?
Well, that's the main difference between film and television. You sort of have a prescribed format that's already set there. You know where you're going to be. You've got the bullpen in the precinct. You got somebody's home. You got a street corner. I mean, it's pretty much regimented. You're not going to go ride a plane crash or blow up a building in Castle. It's just not going to happen. Whereas in a film, you might do that. So, yeah, I mean, it is definitely on our mind, but it's not because, oh, I can't do that. This is the format of the show. We call it honoring the franchise, honoring the format. So you know week by week what you're going to see, and no, you're not going to see these major, expensive $500,000 explosive shoots in the middle of Castle or The Mentalist.
Now, going back to the comment earlier about you know, these different structures for maybe, you know, web or international. I know, Garrick, that you worked in France for a long time. Could you want to speak a little bit about the formatting differences with television for international television?
Well, the biggest difference when I was there is that even on ad-supported television, and by the way, Canal Plus just started when I was there. They were born while I was in Paris, and now, of course, they're one of the biggest companies in Europe. But the commercials in French television were at the beginning and at the end of the show. You know, there's nothing in the middle. So you have a half-hour show or an hour show. You know, commercials start at the beginning and then nothing until the end, pretty much like their film theaters. When we had, I call virgin pristine theaters in the United States, the French and Europeans were putting commercials before and after the films. And that's pretty much how television works. They have more channels now because of the advent of cable, but initially you had TF1, AT2, and FR3, the three major networks. And the shows were pretty much, well, first of all, you have to understand, they love American shows, so I would say about 80% of French television is rebroadcast American shows, dubbed, which is really god-awful to sit there and see somebody speak in French. I mean, it's just pretty funny. But yeah, it is somewhat different. And now, of course, they're becoming more Americanized because now they're introducing commercials in the middle of programming. So they, too, are going through a change.
I was just starting to add, when we start talking about international markets, it's one of those things where all of us, when we're here, we would like to think that we're, you know, the craft is the most important thing, which, you know, ultimately it is. But being able to write something that can be used internationally, in reality television, we have a very unique thing that we refer to as snap-ins. That when you go international, they're also, when he's talking about commercials at the beginning and the end of things, there's also less commercial time because it's regulated there.
Right.
So what ends up happening is a lot of the shows that I work on, if they are being produced by a company that intends them for international distribution, you will have a scene called a snap-in that is a scene that is related to your story but that is not essential to your story that you'll produce. It can't start or stop on a dissolve. And there has to be an exact time and an exact location where that scene can be dropped into the product when it's marketed overseas.
To fill up the holes.
Yeah, exactly. Right. It's sort of like, well, if I'm going to be 43:30 here, but I have to have 46 or whatever the content is, then I have to do this extra 2 minutes and 30 seconds in order for me to be able to sell it overseas. Understanding format is probably one of the most important things that you will learn if you are writing for television, is you are writing within a box and timing and purpose to what it is that you're doing really is everything as far as being a successful writer.
My snap-ins were always the scenes that the network executives made me take out.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd stuck them back into the international one. Because
yeah.
you love them. You love them.
You'll get your day. It'll just be in Poland.
I know. You can only watch it in Poland, but it's still there, and it's a great scene.
Basketball Wives was number one in Poland for a while.
Congratulations.
Great. I like that, you know, idea that, you know, sometimes you're, you know, in animation, you're pitching the idea and you think it's an original idea and they're going, oh yeah, this is great. And then sometimes they have the idea, you know, and they want a show that it revolves around a toy or a product. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and so you gotta sort of, okay, I don't know if I can do it. Well, okay, I'll try it, you know. And then when I was working on Power Rangers, they gave you half the story. It was already shot, you know, mm-hmm. in Japan with the Power Rangers in the uniforms. Mm-hmm. They gave that to you. It had no sound, mm-hmm. you know, and then you had to, okay, what's the story here? And then you had to write the other half of the story, which was the American actors in the studio as the Power Rangers at school, you know.
I remember you telling that story once, and I, cause, you know, imagine getting a show and you can't hear what's happening, especially Japanese.
You kept
show.
Turning up the knob, you know, and it just wasn't there.
It's like, that's like a writer's dream, right? Because you can make the story anything you want it to be.
Sometimes you're just going, oh no, I can't do that. That's not my story. That's not the story I want to tell. But no, it's an assignment. It's a, you know, it's a box that you have to put yourself into and go with it, you know? And then you go, and oh yeah, okay. I can't do this. Yeah, you know.
And there's a lot of room for creativity inside of that box.
There is
too.
A lot.
As much as people want to complain, it's the same thing. Like, I talk about it from the perspective of the shooters on my shows. Everybody that wants to go out and shoot a show wants to put this special lens on something and send you back this B-roll that's got this. They want to do a brown gradient filter so it looks like they're shooting on the surface of Tatooine even though you're in Miami. It's fine. It's fine. And they have the argument about how, well, we're not just out here with boxes on our shoulders. And it's like, listen, be as creative as you want to be. Just hit these specs with whatever it is you're doing. Any creative endeavor, you can be wildly creative within the confines of what it is that's actually necessary to produce the show.
I would even say in reality television, one of the awesomest things about producing reality television as a writer is that, you know, you always had to pitch something to the executives. Mm-hmm. This was going to be my story for my series. This is episode 4 is going to be where the Hogan family brings home a pet monkey, and we're going to rent this pet monkey, and we're going to bring it in the home, and then, you know, that's going to be our episode. But in reality, oftentimes the real comes through, and you have to, if you're a good writer, if you're a good story producer, you can change the story as it's evolving into what is actually there, because the real will always, always beat the fake, mm-hmm. unless it's a pet monkey. Pet monkeys just beat everything. But, you know, so you know, as a writer, in reality, you really have to be able to quickly identify where what is the story, what are the people going to, audience?
A lot of the creativity, I talk about how I work in post, and I'm basically putting things together as refrigerator magnets. The field producers on the shows that I work on have to be incredibly responsive to what's happening around them in order for story to happen, because there are things that I'm anticipating and scenes with objectives that I would like to see. But if something goes crazy, they have to be able to figure out how to follow it, mm-hmm. how to make sure that they give me at least three beats, because anything yeah. that's less than three beats doesn't qualify to me as a story.
Right.
If something doesn't set up and then happen and then pay off in the terms of somebody talking about it or it having a lasting effect on the other characters, then it's not worth putting in the show. Mm-hmm. And they have to think pretty quick out there. So I certainly want to make sure that I don't give the impression that, you know, post is where all the story happens in reality television. The field teams are outstanding.
Yeah. So, Garrick, in your opinion, what makes a good writer for television? I'm going to ask everybody this question.
What makes a good writer?
Yeah, what are the traits, the character traits that a good writer, the best writers that you've known in television have all exhibited?
A great imagination, not being afraid to make a fool of yourself in the writer's room. One of my favorite stories is we were in a group discussing a particular storyline, and this one writer came up with an idea that was probably the most idiotic idea I've ever heard in my life. And then 5 minutes later, came up with an idea that solved the problem, that fixed the story. It's the ability to work with others, to let your mind completely go and create spontaneously, and to dig deep in yourself and just let all the ideas flow. You have to be creative. You have to have a good imagination, and you can't censor yourself. And I would say that to all wannabe writers. That's the most important thing I can probably tell you. Don't censor yourself. Yep. Just let it go. Let it come out. Sometimes you got to write 500 pages of garbage to get those 10 pages of pure gold. And it's a process. It's a muscle that you develop. It's a technique that you learn, tools that you acquire to express yourself as a writer. It's growth and patience and commitment.
Does anybody have anything to add to the...
I would tell you, one of the things that differentiates a great writer to me from a novice is someone who has an appreciation for that which has come before, because when you understand how things worked, one of my great passions right now is I'm working with somebody on a television format that originated in 1948 that I want to bring back because I think that it's exactly right now. So we've got the rights together for it, and we're going out and we're shopping it now. But an appreciation of what happens before, if you want to be a comedy writer, be funny, but be familiar with the great writers who have come before you. I think we have a tendency to be really insular, and we have this voice, and we have this one thing that we want to be able to get out. The reality of most situations is as a writer, not all writers enter this field as creators and showrunners who are setting the tone. This is something that comes later in your career. You know, Chuck Lorre did his time writing for other shows that had been set up by other people and learning how to execute a voice that already exists. Watch other shows that have been successful. Be familiar with how other people's writing works. Be familiar with the people who have come before you. It's super important. You can't just insulate yourself and I only like this type of comedy or I only like this type of thing. Watch everything. Understand it. Watch a Marx Brothers movie once in a while.
Troy, Alex.
Breadth of experience is important.
Alex Epstein says, you know, Google your dialogue.
Oh, yeah.
Do you agree that that's a good thing to do, and why do you think that's important?
I don't think it can hurt you. I think the most important thing is that whatever the product is that you're creating should sound authentic in some way. Once you start doing jokes for joke's sake, there's a reason why the guys that did Airplane succeeded, because they came up with something that felt fresh and felt new. And that it's hard to duplicate because it's not a super authentic thing. It is a little bit of an artificial setup. But most people, most writers that are really good, the stuff that they do has to come across as being authentic. Because if the audience can't invest in it, everybody loves Raymond worked as a multi-generational hit because there was something in there that everybody understood and it was very close to in its themes what almost everyone's life has been like. Mm-hmm. You got to be able to identify, I think.
There's something important you said, though, about training, because that really is one of the beneficial aspects of being on a writing staff. It is a training ground because the showrunner, the creator, sets the landscape and you're working within that world that he or she has already created and you're developing your skills. The beauty of writing for a television is that you sort of know, you mentioned earlier, working inside the box, I call it painting inside the lines, they're established and you create within that world and you've got the inspiration and the input of the showrunner and the creator. You're not alone, you're not doing this by yourself. You are working with a team of creative people who are adding to the process. And as you said, you learn, you develop. You have to, Vince Gilligan broke in with Chris Carter on X-Files. That's how he got his start. You got to pay your dues. You got to be a staff writer. I call it, somebody said, what do you do? And I said, well, I'm a grunt. I work for a living, you know.
Do you get the impression that the tone has changed? I get approached almost every day by people who want to be show creators. And it's not that I want to be a writer. It's I want to create a show. How do I create a show? How do I do that? And the response is always, I want you to go down to your local Army recruiter's office and tell them that you'll join, but only if they'll let you be a general.
Right.
It doesn't work that way. And there's a lost understanding of that apprenticeship period.
Yeah.
That I think people
Absolutely.
Want so badly to get their stuff out that it's just doing your time. It'll not only is it better for you in the long term as being a developed writer, it's just the reality of the business. No one wants to spend millions and millions of dollars and have you who have no experience, you know, running a show.
Yeah, they're not going to do that. And, you know, and the great thing is that you do run the show in TV a lot of time. You are the top guy. You are the showrunner. I mean, you're one of the, but not immediately. Nobody's going to go into business with you if you don't know what you're doing,
mm-hmm.
you know, because there's a lot of money on the line. So, yeah. Go get in there, you know, pay your dues, and it can really pay off.
Well, the network's not going to give you a shot anyway, unless you have a background and a track record. But the key is, for instance, in teaching a class on script writing, I won't let students do a pilot. I said, you know, you got to learn to walk before you run. You got to learn the rules of the game. You got to learn the process. You have to learn to work and create within that framework. Then you can go create a pilot. Yeah. But you have to pay your dues.
Well, that's a really good point. So since we're here with students, what are some of the pieces of advice that you guys would give to people who are interested in sort of breaking out and becoming a television writer?
I can tell you that if you are interested at all in reality television is exceptionally difficult because it's the only thing that you can't spec an episode for to show people that you know what it is that you're doing. Apprenticing and really coming up through the ranks is the only way I see most people doing that. There are people who cross the bridge. It's not necessarily easy, but people who have been writers for sitcoms and variety who cross over into reality television. The process is a little bit counterintuitive, but people get very excited when I say, yeah, I have a guy that used to write for Jon Stewart that I want to hire this year. Oh, yeah, yeah. Sure. You know. But when you come into reality television, you're going to come in through a weird side door. Is everybody that I've worked with comes in as either a logger transcriber, a production assistant, the assistant to the executive producer of The Osbournes was the story producer for the Christmas special that first season because they wanted to give him an opportunity to work into story. You know, and you'll just have to work your way up that way. But just letting you know that reality TV is different than whatever you're about to hear from that standpoint, that the only way to really get into it is to kind of apprentice your way in.
Yeah. Mark, how about in animation?
Well, you know, animation, you can write a spec, you know, script, and that's a great way to get your foot in the door. And you know, you got to figure out, well, you know, you should have a spec script of an action adventure. You should also have a comedy spec script if you can write comedy.
Can you explain for anybody who doesn't know what a spec script is, what a spec script is?
Well, you would take a show that was on the air that was respected, that everybody kind of knows, that, you know, that's won some awards, and then you would just sit down and you would watch it, and you would watch a lot of them, as many as you could, till you knew those characters, you knew their voice, and then you come up with story, and you write the story. You have it right here. Here's my spec script, you know, and you could show it to them, and it shows that you can do this. You know, that's the bottom line. Now, Another way to get into animation would be, you know, there's this, the writing side, and then there's the sort of storyboard side, and you would, you know, you could team up with a writer, I mean, an illustrator, and you guys could come up with characters and make a sort of a storyboard and come up with a story, but that's another way of sort of getting into it. You know, Nickelodeon has, they have a comedy shorts contest right now where you could come in and pitch a 2-minute, you know, idea. You can sort of submit that and they might make your show. You know, they might make your short, and your short could then be a pilot, and then it could be, you know. So there's various ways to do it, but you have to have something to show them. You know, you have to have a spec script, or maybe you're teamed up with an animator and you can show them thumbnails and an idea and, you know, be able to pitch it in a sort of entertaining, engaging way.
And Garrick, what do you think for live action?
Well, first of all, in broadcast television, you have many different categories. You've got procedurals, you've got character-driven stories. You've got episodic stories, you've got serial stories, and if you want to write for television, you got to cover all these bases. You got to show that you have depth. You got to show that you can write within any framework. So I would never, ever suggest that a young writer go to LA or try to break in without at least 3 scripts under their belt, at least 3. You need a procedural. You need a character-driven story. You should have a serial. Because serial writing, by serial I mean a show like Breaking Bad or Revenge, where every episode continues the previous episode, as opposed to episodic, where every episode sort of stands alone by itself. That's a special kind of writing, and you need to understand how that works and how to do that. So there is not just one script. I mean, anybody who goes to LA with one script under their belt is looking for a world of hurt, because you need to show depth. You need to show that you can write across all categories and all work.
And for television too, just make sure that when you go to Los Angeles and you have your specs, if you're out there for a while trying, try to keep them current.
Yeah.
I mean, I got a stack of Bernie Mac scripts that I wrote when I went there that have they're doing nothing but propping up the coffee table in my living room.
And as Mark just said, you know, pick a popular show that's well received critically, that's on the air. Look, I mean, I admire Grey's Anatomy. I think Shonda Rhimes is a fabulous showrunner and an excellent creator. I would not have one of my students write that show if they had a choice, because it's going to go off the air in a couple of years. Mad Men, this is their last year coming up. Justified, it's the last year coming up. So you want to pick a show that's got legs. It's going to last for a couple of years.
So not Gilligan's Island, then, I guess.
But
not Gilligan's Island.
No.
Okay.
Yeah, and don't fall for that story about the person that wrote the I Love Lucy spec and got staffed, because that's a myth.
Yeah.
You know, I was sitting in a room at the end of a sitcom. Matt Weiner just happened to be on that show. He was just another guy, you know, and he was writing comedy. He was worried. He was really worried. He had to write a spec script over the next couple months. And what was he going to do? And he was just, you know, he was just a live wire. So everybody that's on a show and the show is going on hiatus or whatever, they're worried. They're going to write a new spec script. That's what they do, you know, so that they can then show it and get, if they have to get on another show, they've got a new fresh sample to peddle, to show. And, you know, then he goes on and goes on to HBO and he gives them what they want, and pretty soon he's got Mad Men. He's running Mad Men, you know.
That's great.
10 years later. But he was really, really nervous, worried about writing his spec script. I remember that, you know.
Yeah. So talk a little bit about formatting and how important script format is for the different genres. Let's start with live action. You use Final Draft, I'm assuming.
I use several, but Final Draft is certainly one. Look, formatting, I cannot tell you how important that is, because that's the language. That's the language we use. It's like if you're in this country and you're speaking English, you wouldn't try to speak Russian in a restaurant, okay? Formatting is a language you use to create. You must know it. You must work with it. It is extremely important. It's there for a reason. It's not a game. There's a reason for every single aspect of formatting, because a script is a working document. A script is a blueprint. It is a how-to manual to put your story on the screen. Mm-hmm. And formatting is very integral in that process.
Right. Isn't it true that you wouldn't even be considered if your script was improperly formatted? They wouldn't even read it. They just...
Well, every reader, and readers are the gatekeepers in Hollywood, mm-hmm. in case you haven't heard that, be prepared. They're the first gatekeeper you come across, and they have a stack of scripts about this high on their desk. Mm-hmm. And they want to get through that stack so they can get to the next stack. And you're doing them a favor if you have a poorly formatted script, because then they only have to read four or five pages and then toss it and go to the next one. So you will condemn yourself to never having a script read if you don't have perfect formatting.
When I was a development director, I would throw a script away if it was in any paper color other than white instantly, didn't even read it. Just looks like our time is about up, so we are going to open it up to you guys for Q&A. So I think we're going to have somebody come around with a microphone.
Hello.
Hi.
Question for Garrick.
Sure.
For networks such as cable broadcasting, what are some of the people you've known? What was their experiences like getting their foot in the door, where the role they had that eventually led to them getting careers as writers for shows?
Well, I think the path is pretty much the same for everybody. You write a script, you get a break. As I said earlier, Vince Gilligan on Breaking Bad got lucky and had a script read by Chris Carter and was on X-Files. Mm-hmm. And that launched his career. A friend of mine that I walked the picket line with in 2007 when we were on strike wrote for Wonder Woman. Now, was that her ideal show? Did she love that show? Was that the end-all dream of hers? No, but it was how she broke in. But guess what? That led to The Mentalist. And The Mentalist led to an executive producer position on Vegas. So that's how it works. Mm-hmm. It starts with the script. That is the medium of exchange in Hollywood, the script. Nothing is more important than the script. And I don't mean to offend anybody, but it doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, what you look like, the color of your hair, how tall you are, your gender, it is irrelevant. All that matters is what is on that page. That's what they're buying.
Yes.
Hello, I'm Jake and I'm studying film, and I really don't have, no offense to anybody here who works for a network, but I'm not really much interested in working for networks because of one word, and that word is Firefly. However, right now I am working on building a web series right now. It's basically going to be a TV show for the internet. Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping to get sponsored. And right now I'm writing starting next week, I'm going to be writing the pilot. And I was wondering if you had any advice for someone who's like just starting out writing a pilot, who's been doing the work building the show but wants to start writing the pilot.
Well, it starts with a story. I would certainly advise somebody to write a few spec scripts before you dive into a pilot, but I do like one thing that you're doing, and that is starting a webisode. And I tell young writers all the time, that is the perfect place to get noticed, to write 4 and 5 minute webisodes. During the strike, you never want to have writers with nothing to do because they get into trouble. So we spent the better part of the strike writing webisodes. It really took off. It's a great medium to get yourself known to people. So I highly recommend it. I think it's good that you're doing it. But in terms of advice on writing a pilot, you got to have a good story. You have to have characters that are engaging, that are sympathetic, that are stimulating, that people want to spend time with.
And you got to keep it interesting for those.
Well, the only thing I'll add with webisodes is I have a small amount of experience with webisodes, not a ton. Is understanding what length is actually appealing to people. Once you start cruising over maybe 7 minutes, you start to lose people. Are you doing it as a fairly compartmentalized sort of thing, or? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Yeah, I'll never talk you out of that. I just would just say that, you know.
But I'm thinking smaller for myself.
Yeah. Find other examples of things that have worked. This is the thing for me, is it's always kind of like, if something has worked before, learn from what's already worked.
So if you have other webisodes and things that you've watched and web-based series that you've liked, you might want to try to mimic the pacing. You might want to try to do things like just to make your life a little bit easier.
Yeah, you watch them, you'll see most of them are short. They're 3 to 5 minutes is the usual.
I have a longer attention span than most people I know that are watching things on the net, so I'll watch full-length stuff there, but...
Well, older generation, right?
Well... When I was a kid.
I'm putting myself in that category, too. Not sure who's next.
All right. Yeah. Hi, my name is Clay. I'm in the film program. I was just wondering how the executive producer of a show is involved in the writing. Like, I know there's one title with the creator. That's mainly one thing. But how, like, the big names, like, when you see those, like, 30-second teasers you put on the marquee, how are they involved?
Yeah, but television or film?
Television.
Television. Well, the showrunner is the executive producer. Depending on their experience, the network might marry you with another executive producer, but the showrunner is the creator of the show, and they are an executive producer on the show, and they run the show.
Do you mean the executive producer from the network? Do you mean the executive producer from the network?
Network, like someone who would put their name on a project, who like lends... Someone like...
Yeah, you know, I mean, it's usually in TV, like I said, you know, it's the showrunner he's the person in control. Now, sometimes you'll get, you know, like Steven Spielberg, when he did, he'll come in, if his name is on it, he might come in and all the stuff is written and he'll just take it all and he'll go, no, yeah, no. I mean, he'll just completely churn it up and rip it up and change it. Mm-hmm. But that isn't the norm. That's a sort of a very exceptional instance.
The big names.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, normally you have somebody like Vince Gilligan, who is a creator, and he's going on to a new show. Better Call Saul is a sort of lighthearted show that's going to be coming on. He's got Battle Creek, which is a pilot he wrote about 10 years ago that every network turned down. And after the success of Breaking Bad, suddenly that was gold, and now Battle Creek is going into production. But you know, he is the creator, he is the executive producer, and he runs the show. And sometimes, like as I said earlier, with Modern Family, you've got partners, Levitan and Chris Lloyd, who are partners. Other times, if you've got somebody who doesn't have a lot of production experience, then the network will put an experienced executive producer with you just to handle the production aspects of it, not the story aspects, but the actual putting the show on tape, if you will, or recording the show. But as far as the creative aspects are concerned, the showrunner is it, the final word.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Nina Rodriguez. I'm also in the film program, and I totally have respect for the apprenticeship process that you brought up earlier. In fact, I loved your analogy about going to the Army recruiter and asking to go in as a general. However, if you did have a concept for a show, mm-hmm. that let's say you wanted to get out there, but still wanted to be in that process, I guess in the writing process of it, what would be your advice in getting this show? I mean, obviously putting together the treatment, the spec script, perhaps.
If you want to come into reality television as a creator, here's what you do. I would be thinking there are different types of shows that you can do. There are shows that are driven by format, and there are shows that are driven by personalities. If you have something where you have an amazing cast, let's say that you know your cousin is a huge football star who has this amazing life, and you want to build a show around him and go in, you've added value to the show. Even though you don't have a lot of experience, you can go to a production company. You're not going to pitch it to a network. You're going to go to a production company and try and find someone bigger to partner up with you. At this point in my career, I've been doing this for 13 years. I still very rarely pitch directly to network. I pitch directly to sci-fi. I pitch directly to a lot of smaller places on my own. But if I'm going to go in, I have to go in with somebody who already has a relationship with that network, mm-hmm. and I'm going to give up a lot in order to be able to do that. I'll probably end up on the show if it sells or moves forward because I've had 13 years of experience in it. What you can also do is, as a non-participating producer or creator, if you've come in with that idea, you work out a deal where you get paid X number of dollars per episode. It's very difficult to create a position for yourself on that show without having had experience. Because you can get a license fee. There's all kinds of ways that they'll work it out with working with a production company. But you're going to look for somebody bigger than you. You need a tougher friend to go into this particular biker bar so that you don't get your brains beat out.
It is very much of a step process, as you were saying.
It is.
You first of all, you have to have a manager and an agent, but let's assume you've gotten past that that door. Mm-hmm. Then you're going to go to somebody like, as an example, with Breaking Bad. Sony was the production company behind the show. Now, Sony took it to AMC, and AMC put it on the air. But there was a production company involved. 90% of the time, there's going to be a major production company involved that you're going to have to pitch first. And as you said, you're not going to go to network and pitch right. without a production company under your belt, because they don't want to talk to you, because you're not prepared to put the show on the air. They need the security of a solid production company that can guarantee production before they're going to meet with you.
Well, I will say with reality television, there are people that I have dealt with in the past that have a show that sounds good to me, and they'll talk to me about it, like, well, hey, what do I do? This should fall out of the other side of your head the second I say this, but if I hear something that I think is really great once in a thousand times that it happens, I'll say, I have a friend who's in development at this company, let me set you up. I don't, but I would tell you before that, get an entertainment attorney at least, so that you know you're presenting
Absolutely.
A professional front. When
Absolutely.
You go in. So, but it's a matter of building the show that they can't resist, which means having a cast in place or something that's boosting what you do. If I were you and I was just starting to create, I would probably not create a show that's format driven. I would not try to go in with a show like The Amazing Race. I would probably not go in with something like that. Because outside of that concept, you have no added value to the production, and you will probably not be considered as someone that they will hire and create a line item for and actually take your input on.
And truthfully, if it's, and he's exactly right, because if it's celebrity or somebody that you have access to, if you've signed a contract with them, giving mm-hmm. them exclusive rights, then yeah. then you're automatically kind of attached to it in some way, shape, yeah. or form if they want it.
You
if
can lock your talent down for 120 days or something like that,
yeah.
just for the duration of the time that you're pitching. That you need to do that because they want to know if you've got that person's real commitment.
But I'll give you an example. So when I was a development person, this was back in like 2000, so reality was really kind of just taking off. And I wanted to do a show on a bounty hunter. So I Googled and did research, and I found this crazy guy who had just come back from Mexico, and his name was Dog. And he had this crazy, crazy past. So we took this meeting with Spike Television. We went in, and I said, found this amazing guy, Dog the Bounty Hunter. We're going to do a reality series on Dog the Bounty Hunter. And they said, oh, no. No, it's a good idea, but not now. Well, within a year, the show was on television with us not attached. Because I had not gone and signed him up. If I had attached us as a company to him, that would have been. So that was a very early lesson for me, because in those early days,
I've made that
attached,
as well, just so you know.
Yeah, oh good.
It's very common.
Yeah. So that's why, you know, when you're first starting out, if you're not a production company entity that a network works with year after year, they're not gonna be very likely to want to bring you on board unless you are legally bound to that project.
Let me add to that too. Let's get real here. You don't do this alone. Every writer needs a team, and that team consists of an agent, a manager, and an entertainment lawyer.
Totally.
And you do not go into battle without them. You're not prepared for it, you're not ready for it, and they'll eat you alive. And these three people will not only keep you out of trouble, but they'll help grease the wheels and get you where you want to go, because you do need other companies involved. To piggyback what I was saying earlier, this is a list of all the pilots that are approved for this fall, and of this list, 90% of them are Universal, Fox, Sony, as production companies. And Universal owns NBC, and yet they're producing shows on Fox.
Yep.
So it's just the way it works.
And on agents and managers, I'm sorry, I know you guys have other questions, just very quickly. Chad Gerbich just put a book out called How to Manage Your Agent that beautifully explains what the process of working with an agent is like. Agents and managers, the one thing you need to know is the people that they want to work with are people who are already making money. So if you can get in the door anywhere, it was much easier for me to find representation after I had been working even at a low level in reality television for a while, because I had a job in the industry. I was already inside the door. I had some contacts on my own. So just something to think about. Again, you know, going in that apprentice route and spending the time actually learning inside the medium is going to be very valuable to you in the long term, in the way that you're perceived by people that may partner with you, and that includes agents and managers and people who are putting their own time and
and effort on the line for you.
That's also kind of an industry joke because, you know, if you call an agent and you said, I want you to rep me so I can get work, and they say, well, when you get work, call me.
Yeah.
Okay, next question. Anybody else?
If you finish writing a script, what are y'all suggestions as far as, like, copywriting? What's that process like so that, you know, other eyes are on your script, that somebody doesn't steal your idea?
Well, copywriting is a very lengthy process, and I would not recommend you do it because it takes a month or two to accomplish that legally. The beauty of the Writers Guild is that, you know, we'll register your script for you. Mm-hmm. If you want to register it, just, you know, you can submit it online, and you'll mm-hmm. get a certificate that says it's been registered and a number, and it's good for 5 years.
Mm-hmm. And it's only like $20.
Yeah. I just did it.
It's very cheap.
Hi, my name is Jessica. I'm also in the film program. You guys were talking earlier about the different scripts that you would need to have under your belt before going to LA. This is a little bit of a two-part question. So one, you know, episodic and serial, I heard. What are some other ones that would be a good idea?
Procedural.
Procedural?
Character-driven. Do you know what a procedural is?
No, I don't.
Okay. It's like Law and Order, Grey's Anatomy, NCIS, CSI, where the procedure that they're exhibiting in that show is more important than the characters. A character-driven show like Castle, that's a character-driven show. Some people look at it as a procedural, but it's not. It's a character-driven show. And the same with The Mentalist. The Mentalist is a character-driven show. Patrick Jane is the heart and soul of that story.
Now, as somebody who wants to write specifically for episodic TV, do you still suggest having all of these different ranges to be able to show these, you know, these networks, hey, I can write this?
Well, that's what it's for. I mean, episodic, we call it episodic TV, but it's episodic and serial in terms of categories. Okay. But yeah, you have to demonstrate that you know how to write within the confines of a existing story, within the structure of that story. You have to show variety, range, because if you're going to be sent out to meetings, it's not going to just be for this one kind of show. You could, in one month, you could have meetings for all four categories of shows. So you need to demonstrate that you can write for that, for those categories. But most importantly, that you're serious. Anybody can write one script. But if you're writing 3 and 4 scripts, you're serious. You're dedicated. You want to be a writer.
I also think one thing, just if I could just add to what he's telling you, I have a lot of friends of mine that work in episodic, and the thing I always hear from them is, when you're sending them out, don't try to rewrite the universe for the show that you're on.
Oh,
right.
Yeah.
And also make sure that the voice of the character is authentic to how they already exist in the series. Because there are a lot of things that come in where the dialogue may seem a little bit stilted. You have a great idea, but you're not following.
And that's actually what they're going to be looking for. Because when you're in that writer's room, if you're with 12 people and you're not writing scripts that sound like the voice of the characters, then you're not going to be doing your job correctly.
But he said something really, really important, and I want to reemphasize it. And you really need to take this to heart. Do not try to recreate the world of the series. That's not your job. You must write within the specific confines of that show. Don't try to get creative. Don't try to invent new aspects of the series. Don't create new characters. Take what's there and work within that box.
Watch a lot of the episodes before you try.
Yeah. Watch the episode. Listen to it for 10 minutes before you start writing it, just to get those voices, you know, in your head, because that's very important.
I would say that you should watch at least a half a dozen episodes, mm-hmm. and some scripts are available online, and you can even buy them. I would also read 3 or 4 scripts to see how they're written, see how they're put on the page. Get yourself really familiar with the style of that show, because every show has its own unique style.
Yeah.
Formatting can sometimes really be problematic for somebody trying to teach writing, because every series breaks the rules, so to speak. I'll give you a simple little example. The Mentalist, for instance, when they write a slug line, instead of putting dashes between the categories, they put periods. Well, that's unheard of, but that's the way they do it. That's their style. So you also want to understand their format. That's why the scripts are important, so that when you submit a spec script, if it goes to that show, it looks like you've really studied the show, you know the show, you can even write in their format style.
Good question.
Okay, we have time for one final question. Hi, my name's Eric White. I'm a creative writing student. Do you think there's any different advantages or disadvantages to writing a spec script for a big broadcast channel as opposed to a smaller cable channel?
Work is work. You want to show that you can write. It doesn't matter what you're writing for, as long
good
as it's a series.
Good writing.
That's right. As long as it's a successful series, it's well respected, well known. Good writing, as she said, is good writing.
That's more profound than it sounds, by the way, guys. No, really. Work is work. The thing that keeps you in town to do the great thing later is the thing that keeps you in town to do the great thing later. And if I'm working on something that's an extremely low budget, very deep cable show, you know, crazy things happen. I got Dancing with the Stars because I was sitting at home. I was already a story producer. I was bored. I didn't want to sit at home. I took a logging transcribing position, which was the entry level position that I had 3 years earlier when I came to Los Angeles, just so I wouldn't have to sit at home. Mm-hmm. And the supervising story producer for that show was Brian Gibson, who brought me on to Dancing with the Stars. And it was my first really big network show. It was the big break that I got was because I wasn't embarrassed to go back and just be working somewhere on anything. So,
I mean, it should be a show that people know, though, so that when you give it to somebody and if they don't know those characters or they haven't seen the show, that may not go over. So it should be something that people know and respect too.
Great.
I should throw out all my old VIP specs, is what you're saying.
I mean that.
My silk stockings, it was so good.
It's Bernie Max.
Well, I want to thank you all for joining us today for this panel, and especially to give a big thanks to our panelists, Elena, Troy, Mark, and Garrick. Thank you.